What a beautiful movie. Very exciting. In midst of all the shoot up and the chasing and everything, you have a romantic tie up in the end with the lead characters. And I hope you enjoy that. But as far as I'm concerned, I want to deal with this in a little bit different way than we have the other movies. While there are many themes in this movie that I could focus on that are certainly biblically rooted and that manifest themselves throughout it, I want to focus on a single idea that this movie presents that I think needs to be addressed in a more public fashion. And it's a spiritual issue, and it is the issue of betrayal. At the very heart of this movie, which drives everything in the movie, is this betrayal that took place and how it gives energy to this gang who was so terribly betrayed. And as we do that, I want to give you a definition of betrayal. This is a basic dictionary definition, and here it is. Betrayal is the act of violating a person's trust, hopes, or expectations through disloyalty, treachery, theft, deception, or through humiliating exposure of confidential personal information. All of those aspects of this, Ed Norton did in this movie. He actually fulfilled every different aspects of betrayal. So betrayal is brutal, and he takes it to a pristine height of absolute brutality. Betrayal is not just brutal and painful. It is an obliteration of trust that is so profound that the victim is left disillusioned, confused, hopeless, ashamed, self-loathing. Psychologically, it is probably the most devastating thing that you can do to another human being. There is no greater damage that another person can do to another human being than to betray them. That's how this Italian Job whole movie impacted me. But now I want you to contrast it with the ending scene from The Count of Monte Cristo, where the main characters stand together overlooking the ocean on the island where Dantes was imprisoned and tortured for 13 years because of the betrayal of his friend, Count Mondego. It is there that the moral of the story comes into clear focus as their minds are awakened to the reality that God's greatest gifts to us are our faith, our family, our friendships, and our freedoms, which is the best justice God could give us. That's why the closing scene, the final frames of the movie, is a shot of the prison plaque that says, quote, God will give me justice. The principle that I want you to see from these two movies as we look at them together is this: the demand for revenge is never satisfying and ultimately becomes a life-controlling and defining issue that instead of setting you free, it continually drives you and enslaves you. It drains you of all of your physical, emotional, spiritual, and financial resources until you accomplish your revenge. And yet, you are still left empty and unsatisfied, or worse, you are destroyed by it. You ruin your own life. That was the very end of The Count of Monte Cristo. If he hadn't come to grips with that, that's where he was headed. And in this movie that we're seeing today, yeah, they got all what they wanted, and that still leaves you at the end of this movie with this kind of empty feeling. This kind of like, what was it really worth all of that? What came of all this? Why is it important? It kind of leaves you that dissatisfied feeling. So here's what I want to say. There's a better way. There's a better way of dealing with betrayal, and that is give the situation to God. Allow God to make things right. In other words, trust your justice to come from God. In Romans 12 and verse 19, the Bible says, do not take revenge yourselves, dear friends, but give place to God's wrath. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. This process of dealing with revenge involves 10 things. And I want to cover those quickly for you. And I want it to be helpful for you, because if you follow these steps that I believe are rooted in Scripture, it will help you more than anything else in overcoming and being set free from the betrayals you've experienced in your life. The first is this: forgive the one that betrayed you by, you say, well, how do I forgive them? By turning them over to God to deal with. That's what forgiveness is. It says, I am not going to punish you for what you did. I'm going to allow God to deal with you. You are not my business anymore. It is not my job to deliver justice in the world. That's God's job, and I need to turn it over to God. That is the point of Romans 12:19. Allow God to have his vengeance and to make things right. Forgiveness is saying, God, this is your concern. It's no longer my concern. Number two, if a crime has been committed, turn them over to the justice system or file a legal claim with appropriate actions. God works through his established authorities to deliver his justice. Romans 13 says the governmental authorities exist for that purpose. So either turn them over to the sheriff or turn them over to the court to adjudicate the issue and move on. It's not your worries anymore. Just move forward. Number three, pray that God would grant them repentance, forgiveness, and the desire to make things right with first God and second with you. This is the ideal miracle outcome. So if you feel betrayed or have been betrayed by somebody, your job is to forgive them by turning them over to God. Number two, if no crimes have been committed, then to simply care about praying for them that their soul might be delivered from this evil that has caused them to behave in the manner that they did. That leads to number four. Forgiveness does not equal reconciliation. It's not the same thing. Forgiveness is a step in the process of reconciliation, but it is not reconciliation. You must forgive by turning them over to God, but you may or may not be able to ever reconcile. And that's what we need to understand. Forgiveness means I will not personally punish you or exact my idea of justice upon you. I've turned you over to God. That's forgiveness. And I have to do that over and over and over again because those thoughts keep coming back to mind, and it's going to take a while. And I'll also add another thing is if you have a close friend and you're kind of sharing your heart, if you're the close friend that's listening, you're going to hear the story 50 times. Please be patient and ask him, tell it to me again if you need to. It is because through the telling of the story and the betrayal and how it affected them, it helps them to reframe reality and recapture their understanding of reality. And as a result, get this toxic poison out of their system. So it's the best way to love them is to listen to the story over and over without rolling your eyes or being frustrated. They're actually working it out. And you have the incredible privilege of being the trusted person that they actually are restructuring their foundation and understanding reality, psychological reality with. And it's a hugely honored position. Take it seriously and just listen. Say, you can tell me the story again. I don't mind. Tell me as many times as you need to. I'm here to listen and to offer any support that I can. That moves us to the second part of the fourth step, and that is reconciliation means this. It means to restore the relationship. Reconciliation requires A, admission of wrongdoing. Forgiveness doesn't require that. They may never admit they did anything wrong, but you still got to forgive them. But for reconciliation, they have to admit, confess their sin, admit their wrongdoing. B, repentance from the wrongdoing. That means discontinuing the behavior. They have to stop doing what they were doing and start doing the right thing before reconciliation can occur. So they have to admit that what they did is wrong. Number two, they have to stop doing the evil behavior. Number three, or C, they have to make amends. That is, they have to do all that is in their power to undo the damage that has been done to you by their betrayal. The responsibility is on them to rectify that situation and not to try to lay it off onto you for you to come up with some solution to the damage they created. That's for them to come up with a solution. It's their business to make things right. It's all on their plate. You're free. You've turned them over to God. That leads to number five. Reconciliation is a trust rebuilding process, since the foundation of every relationship is trust. Through betrayal, your original relationship has been murdered. Understand that. The original relationship has been murdered. The marriage has been murdered. The person who was betrayed, they're still alive. And the person that did the betrayal is still alive. But the relationship itself has been murdered. It's dead. It's dead. And that's why you can't go back. You can't go back. You need a new relationship altogether. And that is theoretically possible if certain conditions are met. In other words, once betrayal occurs, you can't rebuild that relationship. That relationship's dead. You got to bury it. And now, if reconciliation is going to take place, you got to work together to build a whole new one. Many times, as a pastor, when I was doing marriage counseling, they would come in, this violation was so bad. I don't want to go back to my marriage. They'd always say that. And then I would say this, God doesn't want you to go back to that marriage. And a couple of times, the people have cried saying, thank God to hear that. I thought I had to go back. No, you don't have to go back. God doesn't want you. That one's dead. The question is, will you rebuild a new one based on the foundation of God's truth and his principles? That's the challenge here. But no, we don't want to go back to the old one. It's toxic and is dead, and we're not getting it. We're not taking it back. So number six is, it's not possible to, notice this word, resuscitate the old relationship. We're not going to resuscitate it. We're not going to put the little electrical charges on it. We don't want it. We can't rebuild something good with that old relationship. God desires a resurrection. And a resurrection, by definition, means a qualitatively different kind of life. We are resurrected to eternal kind of life, a qualitatively different kind of life, devoid of a sin nature and all the evil that goes with it. That's what the resurrection is about. A new body without all the cancer in it, a whole new existence. That's what a resurrection is. That's what God wants, is a resurrection in the relationship, but not a resuscitation. Just bring back the old dead body with put a few electrodes on the chest and give them an epinephrine shot and see if we can get them back going again. Reconciliation is not returning to the old relationship. It is the process of building an entirely new one. And that process is the same process that you go through to establish a new friendship. It begins with both parties have the energy and the desire to invest in developing a new friendship. That's why in that state, they use the word estranged. What does that mean? You act like strangers because your relationship has been murdered. The question is, are you willing to come back and rebuild it? Number seven, reconciliation, when it's done right, according to God's word and God's will, is a beautiful thing. But the process involves a lot more than just saying, I'm sorry, and pretending everything's okay. That's not going to work. And it's not going to bring healing. And it does two damaging things. It says that the damage done to the person who is offended isn't that serious. And it says that the person who did the damage isn't serious. And so it empowers them to do greater levels of evil going forward. Neither one of those are the outcomes that God wants. He wants this person to experience full, thorough, and complete repentance. And he wants this person to feel and experience the healing touch of the miraculous power of God in their life. That's the ideal that God is after. Number eight, once forgiveness has been released by turning the offending party over to God to deal with, the person who is betrayed is free to begin the process of rebuilding their life. They have no further obligations to the person who betrayed them, but to treat them in Christian love and respect, because essentially they are acquaintances now, not enemies and not friends. They're two acquaintances. And if you would say, well, you know, that person is just not the type of person I really want to develop a friendship with, then that's where you're at. And if you're saying, well, actually, that's a person that I'd like to, then you move forward. It's as simple as that. Number nine, there's only 10 of these. We're almost there. The rebuilding process will require lots of prayer, wise and godly counsel, and courage to take an inside look at your life and the spiritual health and condition of your soul today. Before you can fully heal, you have to get an understanding. Where am I at? And I need to go back to basics and fundamentals. I am a child of God. I am indwelt by the Spirit of God. Nothing that man can do to me will destroy or undo me. I am loved with an infinite, eternal, powerful love of Almighty God. And how I've been treated by other human beings has nothing to do with God's view of me and my value in this world. Those are the realities and the truths you've got to get back to the foundation of. And to help you do that, you need someone you can talk to who knows the Lord, knows you, and loves you. And that'll be the most important and healing relationship you have, whether that's a professional counselor or just a good Christian friend. And that leads to number 10. Finally, refuse to allow the pain of your betrayal to sour you or to make you cynical about God, about friendships, about other Christians, or about people in general. Instead, give yourself in loving service to other people every day, beginning with those who are still close to you. this will accelerate your healing exponentially. If you say, okay, instead of allowing the pain from this experience to drive me today, I'm going to use the energy of that pain to invest good things in the people around me who already love me. And as you do that, you'll find you forget those pains. The scars heal quicker, and the pain is diminished into such a way as that it actually provides you energy, compassion, and even a transformation of character to see the needs of others and the scars that they bear because of this experience you've gone through. So give yourself to kind of getting up, walking across the railroad tracks, and doing good for someone else to get your mind off of this betrayal. And then I have one last thing that I want to close with, and that is the best accelerator of your healing possible. And that is to make God your best friend. Part of the difficulty of betrayal is that the closer you were to the person, the more devastating is the impact of the betrayal. If God is your closest friend, it diminishes that impact. And so this, I want to say this tactfully, this experience of betrayal is something that God in his sovereign plan has providentially allowed to happen in your life. He doesn't like it. It's sin. He doesn't like sin. He hates sin because of the damage that it does. But he also knows that if you surrender your life fully to him and learn to make him your best friend, your deepest love relationship in all of existence, that this will actually be a blessing to you in the future. Can't see it now, don't feel it now, and don't want to ever go through it again, fully understandable. But this can become a door to a passageway of deep personal experience in your relationship with God. And it's based on this simple principle that God wants to be everything to you, but he can't be everything to you unless he takes everything from you. Because God becomes everything when he's the only thing. And as long as you have something else, your sinful heart will always go to that instead of God. And that's why he allows these things to happen. But he's also saying, I want to be number one. I want to be your best friend. And so these words from Ephesians chapter 3 describe it best. Paul says, pray that he, God the Father, would grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with power through his Spirit in the inner man, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, and that you, being rooted and grounded in love, that is, in the love of Christ, you may be able to comprehend, that means understand, with all the saints, that's God's people, what is the breadth and the length and the height and the depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge. You would be able to understand the ununderstandable. In other words, you would not be able to cognitively describe to other people what the love of Christ means to you, but you will experience it in your mind and soul and spirit and heart. And that's what's the powerful part. You will know deeply within the core of your being that the most important relationship, your deepest love relationship, your best friend is none other than Almighty God and his Spirit mediated through the presence of Christ in your life. And that's why he says, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled up to all the fullness of God. In other words, all that you can handle as a human being of the character and the richness of who God is will begin to dwell in you. And then God will use this experience of driving you through the pain of betrayal into a deeper love relationship with him, so that as the people you know meet you and interact with you will see something different in you, a life-transforming power that comes from the presence of God emanating more fully in your life and character. And that, in the midst of this betrayal, is the blessing. And so the way that we use betrayal is not to get our revenge, but rather to allow it to transform us into a deeper love relationship with God. God bless you, and I'll see you next time.